Okay, good morning and welcome to the first session of the day. I actually closed the door so no one can leave now, right? You have to stay until the end of the session. My name is Carsten Ziegler. I'm working for Adobe in Switzerland, but I'm not Swiss, I'm actually German. I guess you can tell that from my funny accent. I'm working for mostly on the Apache Felix and Apache Sling projects. In the past I worked on many other Apache projects, but that's what my focus is on right now. And I'm also heavily involved in the OSGI Alliance, working on the new specifications. I'm on the board of the OSGI Alliance and so on. But that's not about me here today. It's more about the Apache Sling project, which I want to present to you. And I'm starting with some motivation. If you want to build web applications today, there are a lot of challenges you have to get across. Usually, web applications today are really highly dynamic. They deal with a lot of different information types, like little comments on your website, the website itself, images, videos, whatever. And you also have integration with other web applications, collaboration stuff going on and so on. And on the other end, it's very important to be very quick in developing your application, so you have rapid prototyping and a fast development time. And of course, this should all be dynamic and manageable and reliable and so on. And if you look at these challenges, there are some potential answers, especially when you're using Apache Sling to solve them. First of all, there's Java Content Repository, JCR, which I will explain next. Then I will go into the REST resource-oriented architecture stuff and go to scripting and OSGI. And these four themes are basically the foundation blocks of Apache Sling. And by the way, I guess we have a very small group, which is nice. If you have any questions in between, just feel free to ask, and I guess I can directly answer them. Okay, so let's get into Apache Sling. We have this nice slogan, "The fun is back," which I think is a very, very nice slogan, which basically means the fun is back in developing web applications. At least that's our understanding about the project. There might be different opinions, but that's how we see it. And Sling is a web framework which heavily uses a Java content repository, builds this resource-oriented architecture. On top of it, allows you to do scripting, and underneath the framework, we use OSGI for having a modular system, which is very dynamic in nature and allows you to really be very fast in prototyping and extending your application. And of course, it's a top-level project at Apache, so if you're interested in it, slingapache.org is the website to look at. Of course, I mean, let me ask you that question. Does anyone already know Sling here in this audience? One, two, okay, perfect. It would be, the assumption would be wrong that everyone who's in this room goes right after my talk to the website and then starts developing something with Sling. It would be nice, of course, but I guess, I think there are some three key takeaways from my session. The first one is, if you're building a web application, leveraging REST is a very good way to do that. If you're building if you're building Java applications, I guess using OSGI is a very good foundation because it allows you to really have a modular way of development. And the third thing is, there are often some hidden gems in various Apache projects, which you wouldn't, if you see them, you are surprised that, oh, I didn't know that this stuff exists. So for example, we have some stuff in Apache Sling which is usable outside of Sling, but is very, very useful. I will show that at the end. So these are, I think, the three key takeaways for today. So let's start with the Java Content Repository. We have an implementation of that at Apache, which is Apache JackRabbit. And JCR actually is a standard Java API, which is a tried and trusted NoSQL solution and which is around for nearly 9 years now. The first specification has been released in 2005. There were updates of this specification. And it's used in a lot of open source projects and a lot of products across the board, so it's really tried and trusted. And if you think about your use cases for handling with data, JCR might be a good fit for that, and that's actually the motivation for explaining this. Especially if you think of the way you want to structure your data within your application and how you want to bring it to the web. And of course, JCR adds other nice features like security on top of it, which most often is missing in some NoSQL solutions. So when it comes to structuring your data, your storage should be flexible enough so that it really allows you to structure the data in the way you want it. So you're not forced to do, let's say, put all your data in tables and then have to find a good way to get the data out of the tables and into the web. So actually it should allow you to model your data in the right way. But of course, the question then is, what is the right way? And that, in the end, depends on your application, how you use your data. This could be tables, it could be key value pairs. It can be a schema-based data structure or a totally unstructured way. There are different types of how you can structure your data, and you should really think about how you want to use your data, because that has an influence on how you structure your data. So, as I said, there's a way you want to structure data heavily depends on the application and how you use it. And in addition, usually web applications today deal with a lot of different data. And you might want to structure one part of the data in that way, like in tables, and the other part in a hierarchical way. So there's no one answer to this question. And the nice thing is, if you use a Java content repository, it allows you to structure your data in a hierarchical way. Like we have this example here, where just have a product catalog. I made up this example. So you have a hierarchy of your data with categories like books, DVDs, and then subcategories, and then the final books and then DVDs in this tree. So the Java content repository really allows you to structure your way in a hierarchy. You have these nodes which can have properties containing the actual data. You can put your data into the tree in a structured way, so you really have a schema for your nodes. But you could also put in unstructured data and just add any information, any property to a node. And you can put in very small pieces of data, like a comment or a tweet or whatever, up to large binaries like videos and so on. And the nice thing is really you have a single repository where you can fit all these different data structures into the single repository. So if we look again at this product catalog, we have these nodes, databases, and Apache JackRabbit. And this JackRabbit node has some properties for the book, which is a title, author, and then and so on. And these are actually defined by a node type. So this is a schema for this node. It basically tells that this node must have these properties and the format of these properties. So title is a string, author is a string, the ISBN number is a number, and so on. But you can also mix this this schema-based data with unstructured one and simply add additional stuff like users submitting images about the book. So you really are very flexible in structuring your data. And the other nice thing is that JackRabbit or JCR has authentication and access control built into the data layer. There are different ways to do that. There is a concept called login modules, which allows you to basically connect to any authentication mechanism. And you can then set access controls on the various nodes, and these are inherited in the tree and really control what the user is allowed to do. So if we look at the example, again, this this tree-based structure. I have now set some access controls on the various nodes. So on the public nodes, there's an access control which says that everyone can read what's in this node and in this subtree, and only the owner of that node, so the user who created that one, is able to write and modify that part of the tree. And the private ones really allow only read-write for the owner. You just need to set these ACLs on that nodes, and these are inherited in the tree until they are overwritten maybe by a subnode. This really makes handling access control very easy, as this is done in the data layer. So we have this nice standard, the JSR 170.283, which are the two different versions of the Java content repository. As I said, it's used in a lot of products. Sometimes it's not really known that's inside. And it gives you this nice way of modeling your data in exactly the way you need it. And you can really store all your data in a single repository, and you don't need to, let's say, store small pieces into a key-value-based solution and the images into the file system or whatever. So it's really one repository. And there are some additional features on top. Of course, you can query your data and then search within the repository. And I think the most interesting features is the observation. So you can register listeners. And whenever something changes in the repository, you get notified and see what's going on, and you can react on that one. Like if somebody is uploading an image, you can get an event and then see, do something with this information. So this is the one of the building blocks of Apache Sling, the Java content repository. As I said, this is implemented in JackRabbit. It's not only the reference implementation for the specifications, it's really a useful implementation of the standard. And there is a new implementation with the code name Oak coming up of JackRabbit, which will be JackRabbit 3. And this one will come out pretty soon and will be very interesting, fast, and whatnot. Okay, so this is the underlying part of Sling, the content repository. And now I'm going into the second part, the resource-oriented architecture and REST. If you look at a website, a website is structured in a hierarchical way, right? You have these paths, and they build actually a hierarchy of the content you can access using the URLs. And your web application usually provides information in different ways, of course in HTML, so you can see it in a browser, but usually you're using JavaScript and remote calls and getting some JSON from your web application and so on. And it's a good way, and this is one of the key takeaways, I think, is that you should structure your data and therefore your website in a RESTful way, which means the URL you use to access the data should have some meaning. Like we have here, you really have access the exact book by using this URL, so it's a really descriptive URL. Where in contrast, usually what is used very often is something like that. You're addressing some code with an identifier, and then on the server side, this identifier is used to look up the actual information that's displayed, and this is not really very, very RESTful. So if you look at this, this allows you to create this resource-oriented architecture where every information you can access using the web is a resource. This can be really small pieces of information, like a news entry or this book information, but this can also be large things like the cover image, a video, like a product information about this product and so on. And it's really a good thing to have these descriptive URIs to address this thing. And if you look at REST, this is a stateless architecture where everything, all relevant information to actually just display the resource is in the URL or in the request. So there's no session on the server which contains some state, so everything is always in the request. And the request targets the resource to display. That's the key thing here. And of course, with REST, you're leveraging the HTTP methods. So you're using GET for getting content, POST, PUT, DELETE for updating, creating, and deleting this stuff. And if you look at this, then you might see that JCR is a perfect match for the web because, as I said, the web is hierarchical and the content you have in the Java content repository is hierarchical as well. So this is a one-to-one fit. And as I said, you can put all kinds of information into the repository. So this is a very elegant and easy way to bring all your data to the web. And luckily, there is Apache Sling, which is a framework which makes this task very easy and connects everything. So, usually I have a demo application which I show, but as my laptop died on Friday, I have a spare laptop now and I didn't have the time to set up the demos. I'm sorry. I just have slides this time. So we're looking briefly at a sample application on slides at least. We have a content structure like this. This is a simple application managing photos. So you can create albums like one for travel, Europe, different locations where I've been, and then the actual photos in this hierarchical way. And this is actually a sample application in Sling, which is named Slingshot, using Sling as a web framework. All the content is stored in the Java content repository, and it's using Sling's resource API to implement the application. So when you're doing REST with Sling, you get a lot of functionality out of the box. So you have a default behavior for GET, you have default behavior for POST, like for creating content, for updating content. And the key thing in Sling is that the way how Sling processes your requests is totally different from, I would say, any other web framework out there. Because we are using something which we call resource-first request processing. So let's have a look again at this resource tree we have. We have this root node with a travel subnode and a subnode for Europe with the actual data. And as I said, the URL is always addressing the resource I want to access. So for example, I have something like localhost travel Europe, which means I want to access exactly this resource over here. And that's actually the abstraction we have in Sling is the resource and the resource API. And as I said earlier on, usually these are directly mapped to nodes in the repository. So this is actually the structure I have in my Java content repository. But you could also map this to data coming from different data sources, like a file system, Cassandra, MongoDB, whatever. And each resource, of course, has some attributes. It has its path in this resource tree. It has a resource type, like a book, a DVD, an image, whatever. And it has, of course, these usual metadata, like last modification date, and so on. So the key thing here is this resource-first request processing. When a request comes in, like this travel Europe basel.print.a4.html, the first thing which happens in the Sling framework is decompositioning the URL into the different parts. So it's finding out which resource is actually addressed. So it's looking into the resource tree. If there is a resource with this full pass, and if not, it's shortening the pass by splitting off the things after a dot and looking for that one again. So finally, it will eventually find this Travel Europe Basel resource within the resource tree. And then it knows that actually HTML is the so-called extension. So this is actually the data format which is requested by the browser by getting an HTML page. And we have these selectors in between which specify the format of the HTML, like having a nice print format in HTML. It's an example, it might not make sense, but just to explain the different parts of the URI. So after this, this search mechanism, which finds out which resource is addressed, this resource is fetched from the resource tree, and then the rendering is invoked based on the type of this resource. So in this case, it's the Albium for Basel, and the selectors and the extension, and these all influence on how this the response is created. So just to recap this this mechanism, we have as a first step this decompositioning of the URL, finding out which resource is addressed, and then finding out which script actually is used to render this resource. This is based on the resource type, the selectors, extensions, and so on. And then a so-called rendering chain is created, which in the end invokes this, this rendering script, but you can also add filters, so this is similar to the servlet API. And then this chain is invoked and renders the response. And the main service we have is the resource resolver, which is a central component within Sling. It's the central component for finding resources, querying them, getting them, creating them, and so on. So just to mention that the service is a central one. And it's easy. The nice thing is that this central service abstracts all these pass resolutions and implements it in the way it's needed. And it actually abstracts, which is, I guess, more important, the access to the underlying persistence layer where the resource really comes from. So as I said, in general, by default, a Java content repository is used for storing all the data, but you could also use different storages. So for example, if you're looking again at my resource tree here, what usually happens in Sling is that the root of the resource tree is mounted to a Java content repository. So unless there is another entity providing resources from a different data store, everything is fetched from the Java content repository. But in my case, everything which comes from this Travel Europe tree comes from a database, because I've mounted here a provider for database stuff. And the images come from the file system over there, and all workflow stuff is stored in Mongo. This is really abstracted by this Sling resource API. So you're using a single API to address data from different sources. You're really flexible in where you put your data within your large resource tree. Okay, so this is was the part about the resource-oriented architecture and the request-first processing within Sling. And now we are getting into the scripting stuff, which is now actually the part creating the response for your web application. Within Sling, you have all choices of using the script language you want to use. You can use JSPs, you can write a servlet if you want to. You can use JavaScript, server pages, ESPs, Scala, whatever, and all scripting languages which are supported by the VM. And if you want to invent your own scripting language, of course, you can do that as well. Usually these scripts are stored in the resource tree as well. So they are just another kind of data within the large resource tree. But you can also put them in an OSGI bundle and get them from there. And if you just want to render your information, your data, your resource in JSON or XML, there are already default servlets doing this for you, so you don't have to do anything to get this. So you get that for free. The same as for error handling. It comes out of the box. But of course, if you want to render an HTML page for your book or your photo, you have to write a script doing that. We can't provide that out of the box. The interesting part is how the script resolving within Sling now works. We have so-called search paths, which by default is slash apps and slash libs. And these are the root nodes within the resource tree where scripts are searched. Then, as we have this resource first request processing, Sling already knows the resource which is addressed and its resource type. For example, in my simple application, the resource type for an album is Slingshot Album. And we also know the extension and the selector from the request, so print A4 and HTML in the example I used earlier on. And all this information is used to now find the script within the resource tree. So basically, all these pieces are concatenated to create a path. And as an example, as I said, if you have this incoming request for Travel Europe Basel and so on, the resource for that is Travel Europe Basel. The extension is HTML selectors print.a4. The resource type is Slingshot Album. And then these informations are, as I said, concatenated to create a path. And then Sling searches at this location under apps and libs for a script. So first it searches at apps Slingshot Album, which is a resource type, print A4, which are the selectors, HTML, which is the extension. And then for a script like .jsp, .asp, and then whatever scripting language, or .scala, whatever scripting language you're using. And if it finds a script at this location, it uses it to render the response. And if there is no script at that location, there's a very clever and complicated search mechanism which then searches at different places and, for example, leaves out the selectors and just uses the extension to find the script and so on. So it's very very flexible to write your different scripts and how to structure them to render the response. And of course, you can usually have different scripts for rendering, which is a GET request, and then for updating or creating, which is usually a POST request. But usually, the out-of-the-box functionality for posts is sufficient, and you don't need to write your own script for that. Yeah, and as I said, this very difficult or complicated search mechanism does search by best matching. It first searches with full information, resource type, selectors, extension, and then shortens this information until it really finds a script which creates a response for the request. And just to complicate that, we also have a hierarchy for the type, so a resource type can have a super type, and this all goes into this search mechanism for the script resolving. At first, it looks complicated, but if you're used to it, I mean, I guess it's the case for most things, if you're used to it, it's really very flexible and allows you to just create the scripts at the places you need them and be very flexible and fast in developing your application. And just to have some code in my slides, this is a sample JSP script which uses Sling's resource API to render a response. In this case, it's just rendering the album and the contained photos in that album. I think the code by itself is not really that important. The interesting part here is that this script, of course, is leveraging this resource first request processing. So Sling first finds out which resource is addressed, then finds out which script to invoke, invokes the script, and passes the resource into that script. So you can directly access the resource within your script. You don't have to find out the target of the request, because you can just have in this first line access the resource and then do some stuff with it, like getting the attributes, which we call a value map, and printing out the title, and so on. You can iterate over the child resources of that resource, and so on. So that's, as I say, it's different to many other frameworks. Okay, so important point here is this resource-first request processing, which allows you to create a resource-oriented architecture with this URI decompositioning at the beginning, the resource resolving based on the URI, the script resolution based on the resource and the request information, and this all together is the core of Sling and a very nice way of getting your data to the web. Okay, so let's get into the final part, OSGI. So usually, when you're building larger web applications, modularity is a key for managing the development and your application, because it allows you really to manage the growth of your application, to be flexible, and to just update various parts of your application without touching the whole code base. You have these requirements for central configuration and so on, and nice things. And for this, I guess OSGI is a perfect answer. And just to know this, who of you already knows OSGI? Okay, good. So I will try to explain OSGI in 5 or maybe 1, 2, 3 minutes. It's a very, very simple introduction to OSGI. So OSGI basically specifies a framework which has a very powerful module concept, and the modules are called bundles, which have a life cycle, so you can start bundles, update them, stop them, uninstall, and so on. And in addition to the module concept, you have a service registry where you can register services and find services. So this allows you to, on the one hand, have a module system, but on the other hand, have a service-oriented implementation of your application. And the difference to many other frameworks in this area is that OSGI is very dynamic. So things can come and go over the lifetime of your applications. Of your application. New modules can be installed while the application is running. They can be uninstalled, updated, services can come and go. And this is, makes it very, yeah, very powerful and interesting to use. And as I said, it uses the concept of bundles, and a bundle in the end is just a plain jar file, which contains your classes and resources, but with additional metadata. And these metadata actually contains the information of what other modules in the system can use from your bundle, and what other what things you can use from or have to use from other bundles, if that makes some sense what I just said. So basically what you have is these package imports and exports. So you're exporting packages, which Java packages, which can be used by other bundles, and you're importing all packages which your bundle requires. And this is all versioned. You should use semantic versioning of your API, so each package has a version, and you define in what version you export your package, and you also define in which version you import your package. And then OSGI just wires up all your bundles at runtime, and everything works. So this is the module part. The other part are the services. So I said OSGI has this API, the service registry, where you can register services, and others can just look up your services and use them. And usually this is done by using Java interfaces, so services are registered with a Java interface name and are looked up using this interface name and then used by code. This is a very, very brief and very fast explanation of OSGI. So this is the basic core of OSGI, the module system and the services. And if you're just using this API provided by the core framework, you can already do a lot of stuff and develop your services and then use other services and so on. But it requires a lot of Java coding. As I said, OSGI is dynamic in nature. So you're using a service, and you always have to more or less check if the service is still alive, because it might be unregistered and not available anymore. So you have to take care of all these dynamics. And fortunately, there are some extensions of the OSGI core specification, which allows you to do the same thing with less Java coding, let's put it that way. And the most two interesting ones are the declarative service specifications. We'll have a talk for that in the afternoon, so if people are interested. And for configuration, there's a configuration admin specification. And the declarative services one defines a component model, which you can use to develop your component and services. And it makes all these handling of these dynamics within your application much, much easier. And it also supports a configuration admin, which is a central piece storing all configurations and providing them to your components and making the configuration of your application much, much easier. Just to mention it, there's also the meter type specification, which allows you to describe things, let's say. So for example, you can describe the possible configuration values for your configuration, like which configuration values it has, which type they are, and so on. Just to mention this once would be go too far to explain everything in detail. And we have at Apache, we have the Apache Felix project, which is a very nice project, which on one end implements the core specification, the framework, which is the core thing where Apache Felix started. But we also implement many of the other specifications, have additional tooling there, for example, Maven or AND plugins, and so on, or the web console, which allows you to manage your application. I have a talk about that in the afternoon as well, if people are interested. And just to mention this once, when we started with Apache Sling 8 years ago, a lot of pieces in the OSGI world were, let's say, missing or not, at least in the open source part missing. So we implemented most of the available specifications and donated that stuff to Apache Felix. Especially we're working on all the tooling there as well. So if you're using Sling, you're getting a runtime which embeds the Apache Felix framework as the core OSGI framework and allows you to get your application in two different flavors. One is a standalone Java application, which you can just fire up and everything works. Or you can get a web application, which you can deploy into any app server and use it there. And within the web application, OSGI is running and your own modules are contained in that. So, this standalone part is a little bit similar to the Apache Keras project. It's a lot simpler than Keras, just contains the basic stuff. You get a single executable Java file, which you can then fire up. It starts the OSGI framework. It contains within the Java file all your bundles, all your configurations, deploys them in the OSGI framework and starts up your application. It also contains an HTTP service, like it's embedding Jetty in this case, so you really have an HTTP interface for your application, which is the basic principle for Sling. And as I said, you can also get your application out of the same build as a web application, and you can just deploy it in any any servlet container and run it from there, in case you want to do that. So with Sling, you have this really nice API, this resource abstraction, which allows you to put your data, first of all, in a Java content repository, which is usually a very good way to structure your data and to store it. But you can also store it in different data storages. Like we have support for Mongo, for Cassandra, for the file system, if you want to. And you can combine all these different data sources to create a large resource tree and really put the data where in the place which is the best for storing your data. With Sling, you have a very highly modular and dynamic system because it's powered by OSGI. And everything you do within your application, everything you implement, you do it as an OSGI bundle. You can just deploy into your application and have this new feature up and running. And this now goes to the third key takeaway I had. What we also have in Apache Sling are a lot of very common bundles, which are very useful outside of Sling. So we have something for scheduling, thread handling, and a lot of other stuff. So if you're, for example, just using OSGI and don't want to use Sling, it might make sense to just look at this common stuff and use the bundles from there and get this functionality out of the box. You also have something for provisioning your application, like installing all the bundles and configurations and so on. And of course, cloud is everywhere. We have some cloud discovery, so we can build a cluster of instances and they can discover themselves and you know which instances are available and which are not. You get notifications when an instance dies and all this interesting stuff. And we also have something like distributed eventing, so we can send, if you have a cluster of nodes, send an event on one instance and it gets processed on a different one, depending on different configurations and so on. Just to mention all this nice stuff we have as well. So this brings me to the end of my talk. As I said, our theme for Apache Sling is the fun is back. We are having a lot of fun using Sling. I hope our users have that as well. So it's basically a web framework, which mostly is powered by a Java content repository, but you're not limited to that. You can use all the other storages as well. It allows you to create a resource-oriented architecture based on REST. It has all the scripting inside, so you can really very fast prototype your application or implement your application using scripting on the server in the scripting language you want to use it. And of course, OSGI as a module and runtime system underneath allows you all to have all this flexibility in developing and maintaining and updating and so on. And of course, it's an Apache open source project, which is always a good thing. And I hope at least I can motivate you to have a look at Sling, check out the website, the documentation we have, join the mailing list, ask questions, and so on. Do we have any questions? I think you should use the microphone because this is recorded.
How does Sling work with the CDN?
Excuse me?
What? With the CDN?
CDN is, we don't have direct, let's say, a direct functionality for that, but you can use it. Well, that's a very general answer, I know. Because of this REST nature, you have all these REST URLs, and this matches, I think, very well with the CDN. It's a very vague answer, but usually, our customers are using that. It works.
Is different representations of resources than JSON are supported?
Yes, you can create any representation you want. Out of the box, we support JSON and XML, So you don't have to write your own script to do that. But if you want to have any other representation, you write a script creating that format, and that's it. Any other question? OK, so thanks for your attention, and enjoy the conference.